Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 26 November 2018. The articles we'll be seeing for prelims are these four. First one is about India's endemic species in the island of Andaman and Nicobar. Second article is about the intelligence grid of India. Third article talks about rescue option for bankrupt firms. And final one is about NASA's new InSight probe. The first article we'll be seeing is Andaman Nicobar Island, home to 10th of India's fauna species. So this article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So the Zoological Survey of India, which is autonomous organization in India, has come up with a new database. So this database is exclusively to find out about all faunal species in the island of Andaman and Nicobar. So the title of this database is Faunal Diversity of Biogeographic Zones of Islands of India. In that database, two important statistics is worth to note for our exam. First one is Andaman and Nicobar Island. It constitutes only 0.25% of total geographical area of India. However, on the other hand, this 0.25% of total geographical area of India, it contributes to more than 10% of the country's total fauna species. So about there are 11,000 fauna species in the island of Andaman and Nicobar alone, which makes it one of the very richest biodiversity hotspot in whole of India. For the prelims exam, UPSC asks about the IUCN status of various species present in India. So as Andaman and Nicobar is a very rich hotspot, we'll see about some of the species present in Andaman and Nicobar Island. The first species we'll be seeing is Narcondaman hornbill. So this picture shows Narcondam hornbill. So this Narcondam hornbill's IUCN status is endangered. And it is present in a tiny island called as Narcondam Island. It is located in east of Andaman and Nicobar Island. So this is a non-migratory bird. It has the smallest home range out of all species of Asian hornbills. The second species, which is this Narcondaman hornbill, is endemic only to Andaman and Nicobar Island. The second species we'll be seeing is Nicobar macropod. So IUCN of this species, which is also endemic only to Andaman and Nicobar Island, is vulnerable. Its habitat is only Nicobar Island and it is a large footed bird. And one of other distinguishing feature of this bird is it builds its nest over land and not over the trees. The third endemic species we'll be seeing is Nicobar tree show. So IUCN status of Nicobar tree show is endangered, which means it faces severe threat from many factors. So this Nicobar tree show is endemic only to Nicobar, as the name states, and it is highly threatened by the habitat loss. This is because this Nicobar tree show, it inhabits only islands rainforest. And due to climate change, this rainforest of island is under severe strain. And another distinguishing feature of Nicobar's tree show, it is omnivorous, which means it feeds on insects, fruits, seeds, as well as from plants. The next endemic species, which is present only in Andaman and Nicobar Island, is long-tailed macaw. This subspecies, called as long-tailed Nicobar macaw, is near threatened and it is present in three places in Andaman Nicobar Island. It is present in Great Nicobar Island of Andaman and Nicobar, Little Nicobar Island of Andaman and Nicobar, as well as there's another island called as Kutchal. So it is present in all three places of Andaman and Nicobar Island. So it inhabits mostly tropical and subtropical moist broadleaf forests. And it is a fruit eating monkey, which means it eats fruits and nuts alone. The final endemic species we'll be seeing is Andaman de Grico. So this is also of least concern IUCN status. It is a small, slender lizard which feeds on insects. And this lizard is active only during the day. So there are about totally 10 marine fauna species present in Andaman and Nicobar Island. Out of the 10, 2 of them are in vulnerable category of IUCN. So the first one of that is called a sea cow. So another name of sea cow is dugong. And it is basically a mammal. It is a medium-sized mammal which mostly grazes on seagrass. This mammal, it inhabits usually shallow coastal waters of both Indian Ocean as well as Western Pacific Ocean. So this species is not endemic just to India, but it's also present in Western Pacific Ocean. The next marine species we'll be seeing is Indo-Pacific humpback dolphin. This humpback dolphin is a medium-sized dolphin which is under vulnerable category. So this is also not just endemic to India, whereas it is present in other continents like Africa, especially in South Africa and also in northern part of Australia. So this humpback dolphin, it inhabits mostly estuaries and mangroves. And it is a highly vocal animal, which means it whistles and screams in different frequencies. There are many terrestrial mammalian species which are critically endangered present in Andaman and Nicobar Island. Some of them are Andaman shrew, Jenkins shrew, and Nicobar shrew. Other than this fauna species, there are about 550 species of corals, both hard and stony corals, found in Andaman and Nicobar inland ecosystem. So these corals are placed under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. However, all these species which are already mostly in vulnerable or endangered categories, they face severe stress from many factors. Apart from increasing climate change, whose effects are visible in almost all the parts of the world, these species, they also face the threat of increasing tourism, illegal construction in the Andaman and Nicobar Island, and also mining which is going on in Andaman and Nicobar Island. As these species, which are endemic only to area, are restricted to very small area, any natural disasters can wipe out the entire history of the species. So care needs to be taken to protect these species. So another important fact about Andaman and Nicobar Island, which was recently in news, is the suspected killing of an American citizen by the Sentinelese tribe. So here you have to know about the tribal people present in Andaman and Nicobar Island. Great Andamanese, Onges, Jarvas and Sentinelese are present in Andaman Islands, whereas Nicobaris and Champins are present in the Nicobar Island. These groups mostly practice economic activity of nomadism, and their external contact with the outside world is very, very limited. These groups, they also have legal protection from the government. The areas wherein these groups habitat are considered as reserves under Restricted Area Order of 1963, and outside contact of the outsiders is completely prohibited in this area. The second article we'll be seeing is bankrupt firms in India to get new and quick rescue option. So we all know the bankruptcy cases in India is highly on rise, and the government of India has brought in several rules in order to tackle this bankruptcy problem. However, as the economic survey of 2017 states, many firms, they face exit challenge. So they get stuck in what is described as Chakravyuha by the economic survey. This also affects the ease of doing business of India. So the Union government has come up with a new plan in order to solve this insolvency cases. So it is planning to introduce a quick corporate rescue option, which is called as prepackaged bankruptcy scheme. Using this option, the firms will be able to finalize the bankruptcy cases in the boardrooms itself rather than going to courts. We all know that Indian judicial system, it suffers from high pendency of cases. And this rescue option for the bankrupt firms will also ease pendency cases issue of Indian judiciary. So according to this pre-packaged bankruptcy scheme option, creditors, shareholders will approach the bankruptcy courts. So this bankruptcy courts are set up under IBBI, that is Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of India. This code was brought into force in the year 2016. As per the IBBI code, the bankruptcy courts will pre-negotiate the corporate reorganization plan rather than going to courts. It is also to be noted that many developed countries like USA and UK, they already have this pre-packaged resolution schemes and they are functioning high efficiently. So it is high time that India uses the example of developed countries to solve the insolvency issue and thus increase the ease of doing business place of India. The next article we'll be seeing is National Intelligence Grid. So this National Intelligence Grid was in news because today is 26/11 and it is 10th anniversary of terrorist attack in the place of Mumbai. So this 26/11 attack in Mumbai in 2008, it called in for serious structural reforms, especially with respect to security dimension of India. So after the wave of the terror attack, several steps have been taken to streamline the security setup in India. So now we'll see the steps taken by Government of India to increase the security here. So after the 21/11 attacks, more importance was given to the role of coastal security. So the priority of coastal security was increased and the role of both Navy, Coast Guard as well as marine police of various coastal states was recognized and prioritized. The second reform brought in after 2008 is introduction of a specialized agency to deal with intelligence alone. So this agency is called as National Intelligence Agency and it is a statutory body which was brought into force by NIA Act. By NIA Act of 2009. At this National Intelligence Agency, it deals with terror crimes without having special permission from the respective states. There are also special NIA courts with special judges set up under this NIA Act in order to efficiently solve the cases relating to terrorism. The third important reform brought in was introduction of National Grid for Intelligence. So about which we'll be seeing now. So this NatGrid, called as National Intelligence Grid, is an integrated database. So this database, it connects all the intelligence grids from all the states, providing the core security agencies of Government of India with sufficient intelligence data. So this agencies include Intelligence Bureau, Central Bureau of Investigation, Narcotics Board of India and Central Bureau of Direct Taxes. So this NatGrid, it functions under the administrative control of Ministry of Home Affairs. So by bringing in this National Intelligence Agency, Government of India has efficiently channelized a counter-terrorism measure by collecting and correlating the host of information from government databases. The fourth article we'll be seeing is NASA begins countdown in sight ready for landing. So this article was taken from the newspaper Indian Express. So NASA designed a robotic lander called as InSight. So this InSight lander is specifically designed in order to study the inner surface of the planet Mars. So this mission InSights of NASA was launched from Earth in May. Now it has successfully arrived at the surface of the red planet, which is Mars. So the full form of InSight is interior exploration using seismic investigation, geodesy and heat transport. And this robotic lander was carried to space with a special rocket of US called as Atlas V rocket. And how will this mission be useful? So by studying Mars, So this mission, as I said before, is to study the interior of Mars. It studies the interior of Mars by using radio science experiments using seismometers. By studying the interior of Mars, the scientists can compare the interior of Mars with that of a planet Earth, which will provide us useful insights about evolution of the planetary system. So this insights project will also help us know more about the inner planets of solar system, which includes also Earth. It is also to be noted that India also sent its Mangalyaan mission to Mars. So this Mangalyaan mission is a successful space probe of India to Mars by ISRO. And this mission was carried out in the year 2014. And another important fact about Mangalyaan is, by launching Mangalyaan, India became the first Asian nation to reach Mars orbit and first nation in the world to do so in the very first attempt. And the main aim of the Mangalyaan mission was not to carry out any activities, but it was just for technology demonstration. The articles we'll be seeing for MAINS are these three. The first one is about the recently released World Health Organization's report on malaria and India's status with respect to malaria. And the second one is about China's new Silk Road project. And the final article is about research and development and the private sector in India. The first article for MAINS is Ahead of Malaria on Reduction in Cases in India. So this article was taken from the editorial of Hindu. So the World Health Organization, WHO, which is a specialized agency under United Nations, it released a report called as World Malaria Report 2018. So in that report, it specifically emphasized the progress showed by Odisha. So Odisha has traditionally been one of the very important states in India with a very high prevalence of malaria diseases. In order to tackle this problem, the government and the administrative authorities in the state of Odisha, they put forward some measures. The measures include special training and the work of social health workers, who are also called as ASHAs. Also, large-scale distribution of insecticide-treated bed nets in order to protect from the mosquitoes, who are the vectors in case of malaria. And the third one, by emphasizing on these two techniques, there is almost a half the percentage reduction of cases in the state of Odisha when compared to the previous year. It is also to be noted that it is not just malaria which is highly prevalent in India. There are other mosquito-borne diseases which India is also born to, other vector-borne diseases. Some of the vector-borne diseases which are highly prevalent in India includes malaria, dengue, chikungunya, Japanese encephalitis and yellow fever. Mosquitoes are one of the most common form of vectors in India, there are other vectors such as sand flies and even ticks. So now let's see more about malaria. So what is malaria? So this malaria is caused by a parasite called as Plasmodium. And this virus is transmitted from one person to another by bite of mosquitoes who act as vectors here. So there are basically the 5 strains of Plasmodium parasites which cause the disease malaria. Out of the 5, 2 of them are prevalent in India. Number 1 is Plasmodium falciparum. Number 2 is Plasmodium vivax. So the prevalence of Plasmodium falciparum is more common in India. However, Plasmodium vivax is more deadly. And it is also to be emphasized that the spread of Plasmodium vivax is constantly increasing in India when compared to Plasmodium falciparum. So the government of India has come in with various measures in order to tackle the problem of malaria. The first one is National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program. Under this program, the government not just plans to target malaria but also other vector-borne diseases like Japanese encephalitis and dengue. And one specific strategy, especially with respect to malaria, is National Strategic Plan for Malaria Elimination. So this plan is for the period 2017 and 2022. So during this timeline, the government has specific targets to completely eliminate malaria from India by the year 2027. So apart from this, the government also takes specific steps under National Rural Health Mission to tackle malaria as well as other vector-borne diseases. However, one specific area of concern with respect to malaria is the increasing resistance. Currently, there is a drug called as artemisinin, which is used to treat both Plasmodium falciparum and Plasmodium vivax forms of malaria in India. However, increasing prevalence of this drug causes increasing resistance, and there is high need that the usage of this drug is regulated. So this calls for close monitoring of this drug using an integrated approach. Though the state of Odisha has shown significant improvement, the prevalence of malaria as per WHO report in the states of Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand and West Bengal is very, very high. Especially a country like India, wherein significant section of population is still under the poverty line, malaria becomes a serious area of concern due to increasing out-of-pocket expenditure. So in order to keep the economic development on track, health is a very important factor. So in order to tackle the problem of malaria, India can go on for a coordinated approach with tropical countries in Southern Asia like Myanmar and Bangladesh, who also suffer from similar problem of malaria. The next article we'll be seeing is Along the New Silk Roads. This article was also taken from the newspaper Hindu. Right from the proposal of the Belt and Road Initiative in the year 2013 by the government of China, this project has been stuck with several controversies. So this project is nothing but an infrastructure development project covering both belt as well as road part to it. So under belt part, it consists of series of road development project. Under the road part, China plans to build in series of road project reviving the ancient silk route of China, whereas under belt part, it aims to construct various ports under its string of pearls, increasing its maritime reach. So this diagram depicts China's One Belt, One Road project, and the project it aims to connect China with Asia, Africa till Europe. So we all know the increasing protectionist ideologies, especially by America and other countries of the world. So at this time, China projects this project as a form of multilateral project which aims to enhance the connectivity of the world. It also projects this project as a highly inclusive project. This is because the project is not led by any developed Western country, but it is led by non-Western country of China. This project is, the funding for this project mostly comes from AIIB, that is Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, which is based on China. Though this project is projected to increase the regional connectivity in an inclusive way as per China, this project is perceived to be a form of neo-colonialism by many scholars. So they emphasize that this project is nothing but manifestation of increased capitalism with just Chinese characteristics. However, India has always been shied to enter this project. This project has both advantages as well as disadvantages for India, which we will be seeing now. On the advantages side, it is to be noted that almost all the neighbors of India, like Bhutan, Sri Lanka, have already agreed to be part of this project. If India is not joining this project, it may be forced to be in an isolated position. And India, if it joins the project, it will definitely increase the connectivity. By increasing connectivity, India will definitely have increased trade benefits, not just with China, but also with Africa, Asia, till Europe. So this situation can be a win-win situation. And as this project also includes the maritime part, this can also help India achieve its aim of blue economy. There is also increasing chances that there will be increased capital flow as well as technological flow due to increased connectivity brought in by the One Belt, One Road project of China. However, as advantages on one side, there are several other disadvantages too. So this project of China is highly opaque. Most of the working mechanism of the project is not transparent. And it is projected that using the string of pearls theory of China, China is developing its infrastructure port facilities in many developing countries. So this may push the small developing countries into debt trap. This situation is even described by many academicians as debt trap diplomacy of China. The third important threat to India is due to geostrategic and geopolitical concerns. This project of China, it already passes through the controversial territory of Kashmir. So this China-Pakistan economic corridor pose a serious threat to sovereignty of India. And it will also pose a threat to the integration of northeastern part of India. The final article for the day is Incentivizing Private Sector Research and Development in India. This article was taken from the newspaper Mint. We all know that when compared to other developing and developed nations, India's contribution to research and development is very, very less. In order to tackle the research and development crisis problem in India and also increase the level of innovation in India, government has brought in many schemes like Tinkering Labs. In order to increase the tinkering potential of the school children, and also Atal Innovation Yojana, which is aimed to target both schools, universities, as well as industries. However, India's position with respect to research and development and thus the patents is very poor. Last year, a US trade representative has released a special report called as Special Report 301. Under the Special Report 301, it placed India under Priority Watch category. So by placing India in Priority Watch category, it emphasizes the poor track record in protecting and enforcement of intellectual property in India. So in order to tackle this situation, the Government of India in the Finance Bill of 2016 has brought in a new concept called as Patent Box. So under this patent box policy, the government plans to offer concessional tax rate for the incomes that are accruing to the patents. So what will be the benefits of providing such a tax incentives? The first benefit is it will definitely increase the homegrown innovation. Once the local companies are incentivized by giving tax incentives, they will expand their research and development and patent generation activities in India, which will in turn increase the homegrown innovation potential. The second main advantage of bringing in this patent box scheme is to reduce the erosion of income tax base. So under this patent box scheme, the corporate groups will be disincentivized from shifting their intellectual property ownership from India. So under this patent box scheme, the corporates will be provided with many incentives. So by providing such incentives, they will be disincentivized from shifting their IP ownership to abroad countries from India. So this may in turn contribute to transfer of ownership of foreign intellectual property even to home country of India. Thus, this patent box scheme will increase the income tax base of the government. Thus, one another added advantage of this patent box scheme is by increasing the homegrown innovation and the tax base, this will definitely have a positive impact on Make in India scheme. So this Make in India scheme will not just increase the trade potential of India, but it will also contribute to increase the employment. However, there is a limitation in this Indian patent box scheme. This Indian patent box scheme is not available to everyone, but only to the Indian patenters. So this patent scheme will not cover any ongoing Indian project in any foreign countries too. And this patent box will not apply to the intellectual properties that are developed in other countries but transferred to India. So this limitation may act as a restrictive criteria and may mitigate against India establishing itself as an attractive R&D destination. Private sector plays a very important role in research and development of any developed country. So India, in order to go up in its development ladder, India needs to rectify the flaws in the patent box system in order to establish a homegrown innovation system. Thank you.